Hello, AI has played a huge role both in presenting and in solving some of the big cybersecurity risks that we have in cloud today. I'd like to take a minute to look at how it's even impacting the evolution of zero trust. When people talk about zero trust, we often hear terms thrown around such as policy engine, or never trust, always verify, or assume breach. In reality, though, these terms don't tell us what it is that zero trust is trying to achieve, and that's what matters most. At its core, really, what Zero Trust is trying to do is to establish the same best practices for every single user, device, and application, regardless of that entity's identity and regardless of that identity's network. In other words, identity and network play a much lesser role in this much larger context. In 2022, the DoD published a paper called the DoD Zero Trust Strategy. And in Appendix A, Capabilities, we can see here what seven targets they call out. User, or the identity, that's one of these seven. The device, application and workload, data, network and environment, automation and orchestration, and visibility and analytics. All of these have to be properly addressed in order for there to be zero trust. Now, this paper was written in 2022, 3 years ago, and it's important to note that since that time, AI has grown significantly, expanding attack surfaces and increasing the complexity of trust boundaries between human and machine decisions, as well as the risk of data leakage through model interactions. We'll talk more about that later. Now, to quickly circle back to some of the terms that I used in the beginning of the video, such as assume breach, I want to note that there's nothing wrong with the terms. Policy engine, for example, that's great, as long as you understand that it's not the policy engine itself that matters, it's what it does, and making sure that you're taking the actionable, tangible steps that you need to take because you have this mindset. So, for example, for assume breach, you need to make sure that you're enforcing strong encryption and data protection standards. Why? Well, because if there's a breach, then you want to make sure that the data within your environment is protected. You also want to maintain a comprehensive, continuously updated asset inventory because, first of all, you want to know where your sensitive data is. And second, you want to be able to detect when there have been asset changes, whether there were assets added or possibly modifications to existing assets. Enforcing least privilege access with just-in-time capabilities is really important as well. Too many times, companies really don't understand this principle, and they allow the broadest set of permissions that might be necessary in the event of an emergency, when really this needs to be limited. Mapping and monitoring all the access points to identify and mitigate exposures is also important. If you don't know where those access points are, you certainly don't know how to protect them. And then, of course, MFA, network segmentation, that's pretty self-explanatory. You definitely want to limit any lateral movement if there is, in fact, a breach. And then, of course, having and maintaining secure default configurations for devices, that needs to be automated. You need to make sure that your teams know what a secure default configuration is and that it is being applied via automation to all devices. That correlates with timely patching of infrastructure and application vulnerabilities, too. Maintaining the secure default configuration, also maintaining the timely patching of infrastructure via automation. And then streamlining and simplifying your systems is absolutely paramount. Overly complex systems, overly complex infrastructure results in not knowing where things are and not being able to properly protect them. And then, of course, ensuring that you have an automated system for threat detection, response, and remediation processes with the appropriate checkpoints built in is paramount. You'll want to do the same exercise with all of the other Zero Trust core principles as well, not just assume breach. Keep in mind that simply listing good-sounding concepts won't do anything to protect your environment. It will only be as you're actually building out actionable, tangible steps to adhere to these principles that you have hope of enforcing Zero Trust in your environment. Next, I want to get into the main objective of this video, which was to discuss zero trust evolution, particularly as relates to AI and the dual impact that it can have on zero trust. Now, as I stated at the beginning of the video, AI can both present risks and can also solve for risks. So let's take a look at what some of those look like. Strong encryption and data protection. If the encryption state was not enforced prior to data ingestion, then the model training or inference may expose sensitive data or metadata. That's something to keep in mind as a risk that AI presents. On the other hand, AI can greatly assist with strong encryption and data protection in that it can automate key management and can detect unencrypted data at scale. In terms of comprehensive asset inventory, yes, it can discover unmanaged or shadow assets through pattern recognition, and that's great. However, it also expands the attack surface via its interconnected AI agents and APIs, keeping in mind that APIs and AI agents are also assets. So it's expanding that surface there. Then for data classification and configuration monitoring, yes, AI can use ML and NLP, et cetera, to classify data and to detect configuration drift in real time, and that's great. However, it can also misclassify data, and it can present model leakage, which can expose regulated data too. So you do need to build in some checks for that. With regard to least privilege adaptive access, which is very important for zero trust, it can dynamically adjust permissions based on user behavior and context, but in doing so, it also creates new trust boundaries between human and AI-driven decisions. How much decision-making power do you want the AI to have? How much do you want to retain? For access point mapping and monitoring, yes, AI can identify new endpoints and anomalies from massive telemetry data, which is great, but it also presents increased interconnectivity, which can enlarge the potential blast radius. Now on the next slide, which is part two of AI's dual impact on zero trust, the next item that we have is multi-factor authentication, or MFA. AI can detect session hijacking and anomalies in real time. However, a very real risk is that AI-driven deepfakes and synthetic attacks can bypass MFA. And as one example, I'm referring here to impersonation. So AI twins, for example, the voice, if your MFA relies on some sort of a biometric feature that AI can impersonate, that's going to be a real problem. Next, we have network segmentation. Now, AI can dynamically tune micro-segmentation policies to limit lateral movement. However, by that same token, if there are model errors or data poisoning, it can also propagate misconfigurations at scale. Likewise, with secure default configurations, while it can continuously audit and auto-remediate configuration drift, its automated tools can also introduce systemic errors at scale. The same capabilities that allow it to provide an advantage can also present a risk. When it comes to timely patching, there's also the concern about how adversaries are going to use AI to weaponize exploits. So in other words, yes, you can use AI to predict exploit likelihood and to prioritize your patching. However, adversaries can use those same AI capabilities to weaponize those exploits, and probably faster than you're going to be able to patch. So that's a risk that AI introduces. When it comes to system simplification, AI is great for identifying redundancy and dependency sprawl for consolidation, and that is a big win. Having a simplified and streamlined system is absolutely paramount for good security. However, there is one really important factor to keep in mind here, and that is that AI systems do not provide visibility into how they identify the redundancy or dependency sprawl for consolidation. AI systems simply ingest massive amounts of data, and then they develop their patterns as their learning models evolve, but you don't have visibility into how it came to the conclusions it came to. Keep in mind that over-reliance on an opaque AI system not only is going to reduce the explainability, but it's also sometimes possibly going to introduce a risk here, because if you can't explain it, that means you also can't check it. So these are just some risks to keep in mind as we evaluate zero trust evolution and what AI brings to the table in terms of its dual impact for zero trust, both the risks as well as the advantages. See you next time. Bye.